From Loretto Abbey, home to the Sisters of Loretto since 1928, and the Loretto Abbey Secondary School, and with the kind cooperation of the Toronto Catholic District School Board, the National Catholic Broadcasting Council presents Daily Mass.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, the friendship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Welcome to the celebration of this Eucharist and the feast of the Jesuit saint, Saint Peter Claver. The televising of today's Mass is made possible by a contribution from Margaret and Francis Krauss from Toronto, Ontario. This Mass is being offered for the repose of the soul of Monica Reither and the repose of the soul of her brother Lawrence Reither of Wasega Beach, and for the souls of the Reither and Krauss families, in thanksgiving for the celebrants of daily Mass. May their souls, Monica and Lawrence, and the souls of the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. As we begin this Eucharist, we ask St. Peter Claver, who is a model of humility and service, to pray for us before the throne of heaven. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy. You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You plead for us at the right hand of the Father. Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who made St. Peter Claver the slave of the slaves, and strengthened him with wonderful charity and patience as he came to their help, grant through his intercession that seeking the things of Jesus Christ, we may love our neighbor in deeds and in truth. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord.
A reading from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. Do you not know that in a race the runners all compete, but only one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may win it. Athletes exercise self-control in all things. They do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we an imperishable one. So I do not run aimlessly, nor do I box as though beating the air. But I punish my body and enslave it, so that after proclaiming to others, I myself should not be disqualified. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Jesus told his disciples a parable. Can a blind person guide a blind person? Will they not both fall into a pit? A disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is qualified will be like the teacher. Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your neighbor, friend, let me take the speck out of your eye, when you yourself do not see the log in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. The Gospel of the Lord. Take the log out of your own eye before you try to take the speck out of your neighbor's eye. As a seminarian, we were taught to make a critical evaluation of events, of persons, before we could respond to any situation. It's a very good and healthy idea. See, reflect, and act. But the tendency is to go from judging the events and persons when they make a decision to making a judgment about their intentions, to making a judgment about the way they are thinking. And we've got no right to do that. And from there, we go on to spread gossip and spread rumors, because what we think is going on in their mind becomes a fact whenever we speak to other people about it. And then add to it e-talk and e-news and the TV gossip. We tend to bring down people who are rich and famous, people who do better off than we are, to our own level. And that is basically because of a sense of insecurity. And Jesus tells us, before you try to sort out the life of other people's, try to sort out your own life. We have men and women in our society who are constantly models for us, who never gossip, who always see the good in other people. One of my favorites was Mrs. Beatrice O'Hagan, the late Mrs. Beatrice O'Hagan, when I was parish priest in Chepstow, Ontario, some 30 years ago. She could not say anything bad about anybody. So very often I would provoke her. I said, Mrs. O'Hagan, come on, you cannot say something good about Mr. So-and-so. He's a drunk. He doesn't provide for his children. He is always lazy. And she looked at me straight in the eye and said, but he does have a beautiful smile and his teeth are well kept. And I said to her, Mrs. O'Hagan, if you ever go to hell, they'll throw you out in 20 minutes because you'll have something good about everybody, including the devil itself, and you'll create chaos over there. And she just smiled at me. These are people that constantly are there to help us to look at people the way God has made them and the way God looks at them, to see them as beautiful people. We have faults, we have difficulties, we have all sorts of ailments. But there's more good in each person. And one of the persons, just like Mrs. O'Hagan, was somebody born 300, 400 years ago, St. Peter Claver, who was called the slave of the slaves. As Paula read in that first reading, says, there is an obligation on me to hand on the ministry that has been trusted in me. Now, we're very surprising that on this feast day that we'd use that passage from Paul where he speaks of being a slave to all people to bring them to Christ. And that is exactly what Peter Claver did. He was born in 1581 in Spain, and he joined the Jesuit order to be a priest. And during his training as a priesthood, he met a fabulous Jesuit lay brother, a coadjutor brother. He was 40 years old when he joined St. Alphonsus Rodriguez, and he was a porter in our new college in Mallorca, Spain, for 46 long years. He had a great sense of whenever somebody knocked at the door, he'd say, yes, Jesus, I'm coming. And he saw in Peter Claver a man totally dedicated to God, and he predicted, you are going to do great work in across the oceans. And that would be in Colombia, across in South America. And so St. Peter Claver, when he was ordained, he signed his name Peter Claver, a priest to the Ethiopians. That was the name that was given to all Africans. It was a generic name 500 years ago. He was determined to be dedicated to the work of the African people wherever they were in the world. And so when he was sent to Colombia, he felt that he was sent by God himself to work for the people of God. He was dedicated to the slaves in Colombia. It was a industry, if you call it, a trade, if you call it, a business, if you call it, for over a century. It had been condemned by the church, it had been condemned by the Pope, but it was a lucrative and money-making business, and therefore it would be continued regardless of who said what. And that is why Jesus would say, it is so hard for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of God. Money just makes us do things that we would normally, in our senses, not want to do. And so here he was dedicated to this cargo, a human cargo that came from Angola and the Congo. There were men and women that were sold by their own chieftains because they were not useful in their villages, but they hoped that they would work in the mines in Colombia. And so St. Peter Claver would wait for these ships that would come. There were over 10,000 of them every year brought to Colombia. But out of the 10,000, one-third of them would die on the way. They were kept in holds. There were no room. They were chained together. Some of them died. And there was nobody to take away the dead people. They were chained to those who were living. There were no toilet facilities. So you can imagine the stench. And St. Peter Claver would say to his friends around, I will give a penny to anybody who lets me know when the first ship is seen, the mast of the ship is seen over the horizon. And as soon as the ship came in, there he was. He brought water and oranges and watermelons. Can you imagine how good it tastes even now? But how much more would it have tasted to that human cargo down below? And so when he brought them up, he talked to them about Jesus Christ. But as Jesus said, A prophet is not accepted in his own country. And although he did such a lot of good work, Peter was not accepted by his own fellow Jesuits because that stench clung to his clothes. And so he was relegated to one end of the house. When he died, his room was ransacked in a couple of hours because they realized how great a saint he was. Saint Peter Claver has continually been a model for us. As his words said, we must speak to them with our hands before we speak to them with our lips. Saint Peter Claver, pray for us. Would you join me now as we pray together? Today is a day in south of the border in America that they are praying in a special way for world peace, for peace in America and against racial tension. And I'm using the prayers of the faithful from them. From an end to violence perpetrated by harsh words, deadly weapons, and cold indifference, may our homes and our country become havens of peace. We pray to the Lord. For the grace to see every human person as a child of God, regardless of race, language, or culture, we pray to the Lord. For the wisdom and understanding to receive stories and experiences of those different from ourselves and to respond with respect, we pray to the Lord. For our faith community, that we may respond boldly to the call of the Holy Spirit to act together to end violence and racism, we pray to the Lord. Loving and gracious God, we thank you for the gifts that you have given us and the gift of our faith, hope, and charity through Christ our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have this wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us our spiritual drink. Lord God, be pleased to accept these gifts that we offer to you with humble and with contrite hearts. My sisters, my brothers, pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, on this feast of St. Peter Claver, the prayers of your faithful, and with the sacrificial offerings that, through these acts of devotedness, may we pass over to the glory of heaven. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Amen. Lift up your hearts. Amen. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Amen. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word, through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, Jesus stretched out his hands as he endured his passion so as to break the bonds of death and reveal the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we sing. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Thomas our Bishop, the bishops across Canada, and all the clergy and this entire people of God. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray to God, our loving Father, in the words Jesus himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant a peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share with one another a sign of this peace and friendship. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us and all our dear ones unto life everlasting. Let us pray. We entreat your majesty most humbly, O Lord, that as you feed us with the nourishment which comes from the most holy body and blood of your Son, so you may, on this feast of Saint Peter Claver, make us sharers of his divine nature, Jesus who lives and reigns, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass has been celebrated. Go in the peace of Christ to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Our thanks to our donor for the gift of this Mass.
Lord Jesus,
please remember that all requests for special prayers are read by Father Bush, Father Coots, Father Donovan, Father Lynch, and Father Fitzpatrick. And your intentions are carried with them to the altar for the celebration of Holy Mass.